When it comes to some jobs, it seems like you can never have enough sources of background music. These days, there are lots of newer technologies to stream, network, or just distribute music from a central source throughout a venue, but there's still loads of multi-room events where you just need to keep it simple. Drop a powered speaker and an iPod, set a playlist, and move on to the rest of the work. I bet if you're like me, you probably have a drawer full of old electronics. Personally, I've got Apple devices. This old Nano is actually still in pretty good shape. The battery's aging, but it has held up pretty well, as these units are pretty light on power to begin with. My old iPhone 4 still works too. I've replaced the battery, the home button, the speaker, the mute switch, and a couple of other parts in it over the years, but it still does a pretty good job just as an iPod. But how about those older iPod classics? The ones that are supposedly simple to modify. This 2005 5th generation 30GB iPod Video still works beautifully, but it's really starting to show its age. The screen is completely clapped out, the battery's on its last legs, and I suspect from the amount of noise coming from the spinning platter hard drive that it's not too far behind it. As a disclaimer, I am not claiming to be an expert on repairing Apple devices. This is not a how-to guide. If you want a how-to guide, I suggest going over to ifixit.com, which is where I went to get a how-to guide, how to do step-by-step repairs and upgrades to your equipment from all different manufacturers. I've never opened up an iPod Classic before. I've done lots of repairs to other Apple products successfully, though, so I'm fairly confident I know what to expect inside. I've read for years now about modifying these units to use a CF card or an SD card or even an SSD, and now that this one needs a screen and a battery, I figured it'd be a good experiment. If you read up on doing this yourself, you might notice a lot of the comments and questions on the various blogs and videos that talk about doing this upgrade, and there's lots of positive feedback and successful reports, but also a good amount of people with interesting issues that seem to have popped up along the way. And while this should be a very straightforward modification, there's a fair number of people out there that seem to have either unanswered or tricky to answer questions after doing the basic work. So my goals for this iPod are 1, to replace the battery. Pretty simple. 2, I want to replace the screen. Obviously, that's no good. I'd love 3, to remove any of the scratches, at least over the screen, and if not, on the whole iPod. It would be nice just to kind of recondition it, get rid of some of the scratches. But if nothing else, over the screen, and then obviously swap the old hard drive for something more reliable and less power hungry. So let's talk parts. I got a new screen here, which is one of the most expensive parts of the project so far, and that came in at $26 from Amazon. I got a cheap replacement battery that cost about $7 and came with some tools to help with installation, again through Amazon. I watched this strange old video recently with a guy using Wyman brand, that's W-E-I-M-A-N brand metal polish, to completely remove all of the scratches on an iPod Classic's metal and plastic. I mean, it really came out nice. And so, wanting to do my part to shop local and everything, I walked over to my local city hardware shop here and picked up this Flitz metal polish, with it being as close as they had to the Wyman, and it's EcoSafe also. And that ran me about $10. And finally, after a whole bunch of reading and debating, I went with this suspiciously cheap CF to ZIF adapter board, and that's ZIF, Z-I-F, Zero Insertion Force adapter board, for only $13, again on Amazon, but you can find those on eBay as well. Now, you can spend days reading about all the different adapter boards out there. These type of boards are available from a single CF card, a single SD card, dual SD cards, quad SD cards, and even adapters that'll let you use other types of standard hard drives and SSD solid state drives. I really debated on which way to go. And I decided that since I already have a bunch of high capacity and high quality CF cards for my cameras, that I might as well try the cheapest version to me first. And I went with this cheap adapter. Now, I want to point out here that if you don't already have CF cards laying around, this won't be the cheapest option for you. CF cards, especially fast ones and high capacity ones, are getting harder and harder to find, and they're just expensive. I buy them for a Canon camera that needs needs them, but they're very expensive to buy compared to SD cards these days. So like I said, this is not a how-to on how to repair or upgrade Apple products, but I will give you some basic rules for playing with Apple products. And this is from iPods to phones to the laptops. One, if you've got a device with a hold button, go ahead and make sure the device is as powered down as you can get it and engage that hold button before you open it up or do anything else. That's just smart with any electronics, probably. Number two, for prying the case apart, you want to use some sort of flexible or bendable tool. We call them spudgers normally, but guitar picks are really handy. Anything else that you can use like that, that's able to wedge in between parts of the case to kind of pry and wedge them open. But you want the tool to bend or break, not the device itself. Never pry with a screwdriver. You will absolutely break things on Apple products by doing that. When you do gain entry to the device, there will always be, in my experience, some sort of ribbon cables connecting the two halves that you just separated. So if you were to take the iPod and yank it apart, you will destroy so much stuff. That holds true for the iPhone. That holds true for any laptop I've ever taken apart from Apple. When you break the case open finally, don't get too excited. Go very carefully. The zero insertion force connectors are really simple to use. It's generally just a matter of flipping up a little tab or a little paddle. But if you go too fast or you go too aggressively, you can absolutely break them and you'll be really upset that you did. And number four, to go along with that, take your time. These devices are maybe a little fiddly. They're very small, but they are laid out very logically. And if you take your time and just step back a little bit and kind of take an overview of what you're looking at before you rush in, I think you'll figure out what's going on inside most of these devices pretty quickly. So the first step is to pry open the case. And that's not that hard on these iPod Classics because they're plenty large and it's pretty easy to get your spudging tool into. To make life easier, I want to remove the battery first to get it out of the way while I work on everything else. Next, we can remove the front plate from the middle chassis to continue getting at the screen. There's going to be another ZIF connector, and once that's out, the screen comes out pretty easily. This iPod has accumulated a lot of debris internally over the years. Some general dirt, some glitter from events, and even a bit of a sandy grit mixed in. The gummy rubber hard drive bumpers were the worst of the lot. So those are going to go into a nice warm soapy water solution with the other loose plastic parts. The rest of the components get a good cleaning with alcohol and some cotton buds. Next, I want to tackle the exterior while I have the electronics separated. I'm not sure what to expect from this polish, but I doubt it would be good for a printed circuit board. So it says to apply it with a dry cloth and buff it off with a soft cloth without letting it dry. I've got some fresh dry shop rags here, so let's try it out on the metal first. Now, it's got a very distinct smell of raw metal while you're polishing. Like, it really smells right now like it's doing a lot, but it's not doing nearly the job that the Wyman stuff did in that video I watched, and it's starting to actually make the text on the back noticeably lighter, so I think it's time to stop right here. Maybe it'll fare a little bit better on the plastic. Again, the same method. I'll put it on with a dry cloth and buff it out. Maybe I should try a second coat. I honestly think it's made the plastic here worse. That's a complete fail on the Flitz polish for iPod Classics. I wouldn't suggest trying this polish at all. So we'll deal with the exterior later, I suppose. Let's get that replacement screen installed. Making sure that the inside of the front panel window is clean of fingerprints and moisture, the screen just pops back in and the ZIF connector is closed pretty easily. For a part like this, using a simple piece of tape to hold the screen in will let you concentrate on inserting the connector much better with two hands. And that should be it for the screen, really. I've got a 32GB, 120MB per second UDMA7 SanDisk Extreme CF card here. I've formatted it to FAT32 and it should be ready to go. Just insert that into the adapter and the adapter into the iPod, the correct way around, of course, and we should be all set in that department. Now all we need to do is to pop in a new battery and give things a quick test. According to the guides, we should be prompted to connect connect to iTunes to restore the iPod, which should get everything back to new. So that's not supposed to happen. So we're getting a message to go to Apple support, which is not the plug into iTunes message we wanted. Maybe if we try to plug into the computer, it'll get us somewhere. No, that's different. So now it's showing a battery low warning. This battery might be really low from the factory, but I've never actually seen this warning on an iPod before, so I'm curious to see where this leads. So I'm going to pause here and let this charge up for a good long while just to be sure it's got a good charge before we go any further. I don't want to end up chasing our tail around this problem. So I left the iPod overnight and got the same results. I've spent a while now going back and forth with different methods of formatting the CF card, using different utilities to format and repartition it, even swapping the old hard drive back in, which still worked. I was able to enter disk mode on that and then use Carbon Copy Cloner to make a clone of the original drive over to the CF card. Still though, no matter what I do, when that adapter is installed, I get the low battery error. I'm not sure if the adapter is defective, incompatible with my CF cards, or otherwise just bad. But this approach of trying the cheap route just hasn't worked out. Like a lot of technology, it's often more costly in time and effort to mess around trying to rig together cheap, unsupported hardware than it would have been just to buy the quality, supported stuff the first time. To that end, I've ordered an SD card adapter from iFlash.xyz. Now, these are modern, well-documented adapters. I'll be using a new SD card from their list of verified working cards, and when those arrive in the next few days, we'll see how they compare to the cheap generic approach. I've also ordered the same polish from Wyman that was used in that original video I showed earlier, so we'll see if we can recreate those like-new results on this case. But if not, I've also ordered a replacement front half of the case so we can at least get that screen looking as good as possible. So stay tuned for part two, coming in the next week or two, depending on how everything arrives. That's it for this time. I hope you enjoyed this type of video. In the next few months, I'm traveling a lot for work, so I'll be doing different types of videos as I can fit them in around my schedule and various locations. Thanks for all your support on Patreon directly, by following the various affiliate links, and by sharing these videos with your communities. It all helps make more videos possible. Thanks again. I'll see you next time.